the village of Iping, where we would book two rooms at the local inn. So why didn't he stay in the room? Why didn't he stay in the Father Shipley told her, I think there was no more. Yeah, it was a crowded place. London was a crowded place. London was a very old place. What else? Combined together makes it something happen. Mendel was basically this Griffin was a scientist who had consumed a drug which had made him schizophrenic. But time and now, whenever he would eat something, he would become invisible. But he would be traced by people at one or the other place. It had become almost impossible for him to manage as an invisible man in that crowded and old place like London. He wanted to go to a place where there would not be much crowd and where no one would know him as being invisible. Right? So he decided to go to another place which would not be very crowded and where no one would be able to spot him as an invisible man. So he would go to hiking. And then at Iping, he will take shelter in an inn. Okay. I-N-N. What is it? What is inn? It's a, huh? Yeah, you can say a small hotel, but hotels are, you know, the ones which are very luxurious and all, but inns are small, you can say, places where one can take shelter and food. But to get away from crowded London, he took a train to the village of Iping, where he booked two rooms at the local inn. The arrival of a stranger at an inn in winter was, in any case, an unusual event. So during winters, not many tourists used to go to Iping. It was an unusual thing that a tourist would come to Iping in winter. A stranger of such uncommon appearance set all tongues wagging. Will somebody tell me its meaning? Yes, Khushi. Yes, very good. So a stranger of such uncommon appearance. You people must be remembering, like, how was he dressed up? An overcoat, then a face all full of bandages, goggles, hat, pink nose, right? So with this kind of uncommon appearance, everybody started talking, like, about him, okay? So everybody's tongue started wagging me, so everybody started talking about him. So this man became the talk of the town. Everybody started talking about him, like, see, there is a strange man, something like this. Okay, so good expression. A stranger of such appearance set all tongues wagging. Dogs are tail wags, but the people, those who gossip, their tongues also wag. See the comparison. So talking uselessly is so bad, right? So Mrs. Hall, the landlord's wife, made every effort to be friendly, but Griffin had no desire to talk and told her, my reason for coming to Iping is a desire for solitude. What is solitude? Loneliness.
I do not wish to be disturbed in my work. Besides, an accident has affected my face. So Mrs. What was her name? Mrs. Hall. She was the landlady of that inn. She tried to be very friendly with this customer. But he told her like, I want privacy. I don't want to be disturbed in my work. And moreover, because everybody was suspicious about his face, then he told her like, I got my face injured in an accident, so I have put on the bandages. Got it? So satisfied that her guest was an eccentric scientist, and in view of the fact that he had paid her in advance, Mrs. Hall was prepared to excuse his strange habits and irritable temper. So Mrs. Hall did not mind his strange habits and irritable temperament because of two reasons. One, that person had given her all rent and everything, right? Money wise, he had satisfied her. Number two, that person told her that he got injured in an accident. So now she was satisfied. She did not want to ask him anything. She didn't want to disturb him. Okay, but so far, supposing somebody comes to our house to take shelter, won't we be satisfied like who that person is? If this kind of person with this kind of appearance comes up, then we would try our level best to know like what might have happened to his mouth face. So she was satisfied. Two reasons. He gave her full money, full rent. Secondly, he told her the reason of his that kind of strange appearance. Now she was satisfied. Okay. So satisfied, okay. Mrs. Hall was prepared to excuse his strange habits and irritable temper. But the stolen money did not last long. From where did he steal the money? From where had he stolen the money? From that store earlier, you know, from where he had got the coat and all. Griffin had to admit that he had no more ready cash. He pretended, however, that he was expecting a check to arrive at any moment. So he told the landlady that he did not have any cash, but he was expecting a check which would come at any moment, right? So though he had given the rent in advance and all, but even then he was getting so much of expenditure done on his meals and all. So he had to pay quite often, but that money he did not have, and he pretended as if his check would come. Will his check come? No. What will he do? Like earlier, he will again do some stealing. Shortly afterwards, a curious episode occurred. Very early in the morning, a clergyman and his wife were awakened by noises in the study. Creeping downstairs, they heard the chink of money being taken from the clergyman's desk. Without making any noise and with a poker grasped firmly in his hand, the clergyman flung open the door. Surrender. So what happened? A strange episode occurred in the village. In the early morning, it might have been 3 o'clock or something. The clergyman and his wife, they were awakened by the sounds coming from their study. When the couple reached the study, they found that a chunk of money, you can say a bundle of currency, was being taken away from the drawer. But who was taking it out? That was not clear. Because it was the invisible man who was taking the money out of that drawer. So they saw him taking money out. But they did not see anyone who was doing it. Got it? So without making any noise and with a poker grasped. What is poker? Something, some stick like of thing in the hand. So the clergyman had a stick kind of thing in his hand and he flung upon the door. Then to his amazement, he realized that the room appeared to be empty. He and his wife looked under the desk and behind the curtains and even up the chimney. There wasn't a sign of anyone. Yet the desk had been opened and the housekeeping money was missing. Extraordinary affair, the clergyman kept saying for the rest of the day. So why was it an extraordinary affair? Because the money was taken out in front of them. But who took out the money? That was not clear. They tried to find that man out from behind the curtains, from under the desk, but that man was not found. So they called it an extraordinary affair. Got it? Because they could not spot the man. So it was not an extraordinary, it was not as extraordinary as the behavior of Mrs. Hall's furniture a little later that morning. So what happened at the house of clergyman was extraordinary, but it was not as extraordinary as was something which happened at Mrs. Hall's inn. So what happened with her furniture? That was very, very strange. So let's see what happens with her furniture. The landlord and his wife were up very early and were surprised to see the scientist's door wide open. So it was the same morning when the scientist had gone to do the stealing from the clergyman's house. So when he was there as an invisible man, Mrs. Hall and her husband woke up very early and they saw the scientist's door wide open. Usually it was shut and locked, and he was furious if anyone entered his room. The opportunity seemed too good to be missed. What was the opportunity? Very good, very intelligent answer. So it was a very good opportunity, and Mr. Hall and Mrs. Hall didn't want to miss it. The opportunity was that the scientist always used to keep his room locked and shut, and today he was not there. So first of all, being the landlords, they had to see why the door was open. Maybe somebody else had entered the room. And secondly, it was a chance for them to see the kind of room he had, what he might have been doing inside. They wanted to see. The opportunity seemed too good to be missed. They peeped round the door, saw nobody, and decided to investigate. The bedclothes were cold, showing that the scientist must have been up for some time, and the stranger still, the clothes and bandages that he always wore were lying about the room. So they looked around, nobody was there, and they even found that all the clothes, the bandages and everything, it was lying around. All of a sudden, Mrs. Hall heard a sniff close to her ear. What is sniff? Sound of breathing. All of a sudden, Mrs. Hall heard somebody sniffing just near her ears. So what it might be? It might have been the invisible man who was standing somewhere near her. A moment later, the hat on the bedpost leapt up and dashed itself into her face. So that very minute, the hat started springing up. The hat jumped up and it was flung upon her face. Then the bedroom chair became alive. How could the bedroom chair become alive when somebody might have picked it up and thrown it? As springing into the air, it charged straight at her. So the chair was also thrown at her, legs foremost. As she and her husband turned away in terror, the extraordinary chair pushed them both out of the room and then appeared to slam and lock the door after them. So the chair threw them out, pushed them out, and eventually the chair closed the door and all. So was the chair actually doing all this? It was the invisible man who was making all this happen. Mrs. Hall almost fell down the stairs in hysterics, in madness. She became almost mad. She was convinced that the room was haunted by spirits and that the stranger had somehow caused these to enter into her furniture. So Mrs. Hall, she was like, she almost became mad. And of course, if you will see something like this for the first time, you will also feel the same thing, that it might have been haunted. So she felt like that the room is haunted, and it was a scientist who made the room haunted or the furniture haunted. Got it? My poor mother used to sit in that chair, she moaned, to think it should rise up against her, against me now. So she says, it's a humor also. Mrs. Hall, she says that my mother used to sit upon it, and moreover, that very chair, my mother's chair has hit me today. I can't imagine. Okay. The feeling among the neighbors was that the trouble was caused by witchcraft. What is witchcraft? Black magic. The neighbors also thought like it all happened because of witchcraft. But witchcraft or not, when news of the burglary at the clergyman's home became known, the strange scientist was strongly suspected of having had a hand in it. Now, there were two incidents of the same kind. At this inn, the furniture had danced, and there at clergyman's house, the money had been stolen. And the way it was stolen, and the way here the furniture was banging, these two things were same. And now people started suspecting the scientist. Can you tell me why they started suspecting scientists about the burglary also? Yes. It was not the shop, it was the study. Okay, study room. Not exactly. My point is, what is the connection between these two episodes? And how did these people make out that there was a connection? My point is basically this. Yes, I am. Because Griffin, he brought cash to them that day. But we have not read this. Till now, what's the indication that both incidents are interconnected? What's the proof? Suppose you are a detective. Suppose you are in CBI. Okay, you have to go after the proof. Okay, everybody can make out both incidents are connected. There also something was invisible. There also something was invisible. But what proof will you give it might have been the scientist? What's the proof? Kushi, yes. Yes. Yes, that's correct. Rishti, you also want to say same? Yes. Whose face? Okay, yes, you are also right. So basically the point is as a detective, what proof will you be giving? The proof was at the time when the stealing happened there, at that very time, the scientist was not inside his room. His room was open. That is the proof. So that is why everybody started suspecting him only. And that is also right. He only was a stranger in the village, in a small place, I think. If a new person goes there, that person becomes famous or known very easily. Okay? So he had left London because he was being spotted by people, but no one was able to identify him. But here in a small place, he was being identified. So the village constable was. The suspicion grew even stronger when he suddenly produced some ready cash.
Yes.
The Chayang's point has come. So suppose we were detective. The first point we already have, that he was not there. Secondly, the moment he produced ready cash, that was again a proof that he might have done the stealing. Though he had admitted not long before that he had no money. And on that very day, he had admitted that he had no money. And now he produced ready cash. So on one hand, there had been a stealing. And on other hand, in his own house, in his own room, the chairs had been banging. So all these things together made it very clear that he might have been the culprit. The village constable was secretly sent for. Sent for means called. Instead of waiting for the constable, Mrs. Hall went to the scientist, who had somehow mysteriously appeared from his empty bedroom. So now Mrs. Hall did not wait for the constable. She went to the room of scientist, the one who had mysteriously come from somewhere. Just a few minutes before, when they had entered, when Mrs. Hall and Mr. Hall had entered the room, when it was open, then no one was there. And then chairs threw them out. But then he was inside. From where he came? That was the question. I want to know what you have been doing to my chair upstairs, she demanded. And I want to know how it is you came out of an empty room and how you entered a locked room. So her questions are very, genuine. The scientist was always quick-tempered. What do you mean by quick-tempered? Short-tempered, very annoyed, the one who gets angry very soon. So the scientist was always quick-tempered. Now he became furious. You don't understand who or what I am? He shouted, very well, I'll show you. So what's the drawback of the people who get annoyed very soon? What happens? They don't mind even exposing themselves. Okay? That's why one should not be quick-tempered. So he says, okay, now I'll tell you who I am. You want to know who I am? Then I'll tell you what I am. Suddenly, he threw off bandages, spectacles, and even nose. It took him only a minute to do this. The horrified people in the bar found themselves staring at a headless man. Mr. Jeffers, the constable, now arrived and was quite surprised to find that he had to arrest a man without a head. But Jeffers was not easily prevented from doing his duty. If a magistrate's warrant ordered a person's arrest, then that person had to be arrested with or without his head. So it was not that Jeffers was not easily prevented from doing his duty. So what could prevent him from duty? If he did not have the orders, if he had orders, only then he could arrest. And if you have got the magistrate's order, you can arrest a man even if the man doesn't have the head. Okay? There followed a remarkable scene as a policeman tried to get hold of a man who was becoming more and more invisible as he threw off one garment after another. Finally, a shirt flew into the air and the constable found himself struggling with someone he could not see at all. Got it? Some people tried to help him but found themselves hit by blows. So some people tried to help him. Who is him? Constable. Some people tried to help the constable by catching him, but they were also hit by blows. That seemed to come from nowhere. In the end, Jeffords was knocked unconscious as he made a last attempt to hold on to the unseen scientist. So finally, Jeffords was knocked unconscious. He became unconscious because he was very terribly hit by the scientist. There were nervous, excited cries of hold him, but this was easier said than done. Griffin had shaken himself free, and no one knew where to lay hands on him. So finally, the scientist had liberated himself from the clutches of all these people, and he would manage to run off from here, and nobody knew where he had gone. Okay, this is just one chapter of the whole novel, The Invisible Man. If you liked it, you read it. Okay. So today you people go through its questions. Okay, tomorrow we will discuss the questions of this chapter.